verse 13 through 18. It's in the Life Recovery Bible, the title is True Wisdom Comes from God. Verse 13 is, if you are wise and understanding God's and understand God's ways, prove it by living an honorable life, doing good works with humility that comes from wisdom. You know, I don't know why, but they wanted me to be the wise guy tonight and talk about God's wisdom. And Paul talks about being a wise man, and wisdom is knowledge, but it's not just knowledge. It's how we use knowledge. And James is talking about how we use God's knowledge, or the knowledge of God, and our spiritual knowledge. And spiritual wisdom is the opposite of foolishness, and which James gets into in the next three verses. But divine wisdom is placed into our hearts and produces a change in our life. And Psalm 51 is one of my favorites, and I think it's also one of Royce's favorites. It's Psalm 51:6 says, "Behold, you delight in the truth in the inward being, and you teach me wisdom in the secret heart." And truth in the inward being, this is the humility that is God's delight. God delights in our humility, because it shows that we are depending totally on Him and nothing on ourselves. Oh, praise God. And the wisdom is the knowledge of God's grace. This is the part of David's confession of sins that brought the death penalty, adultery, conspiracy, murder. Yet God, in His infinite wisdom and unending grace, gave David forgiveness. Psalm 51 speaks, "The fear of Jehovah is the beginning of wisdom. A good understanding have all they that do His commandments. His praise endureth forever." And fear here is not being afraid of God. We don't have to be afraid of God. He's not a wrathful God. He's a loving God. And the fear that is talking about is respect, the fear of respect or reverence. And as we learn more about God's love, we become more obedient. It's like love breeds obedience. I know I have this little puppy, and she amazes me sometimes, because I give her all kinds of attention, I give her all kinds of love, and then I'll tell her to do something, and she's right there. Mm-hmm. It's like, you know, it's like I said, obedience, love produces obedience. If we follow God's love, we will be obedient. Jesus said, "If you love me, obey my commandments." Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Ecclesiastes 7:12. "Wisdom gives life to those who have it. Godly wisdom secures our relationship with Him. It brings life to the soul. It's wisdom, not material offerings, that obtain the favor of God, that we will be blessed if we use His wisdom rather than try to do works, rather than try to do things for people to guide them in His way, and we will get blessed for it. There's actually a section in the Bible that teaches wisdom. It's five books. There's Job, Psalms, Proverbs, Ecclesiastes, and Songs of Solomon. And the last one, I've read a couple times, and I'm still trying to figure out the wisdom part of it, but because it's so, I don't know, it's like it's written in another vernacular, another type of way of thinking. And but it's about love, and it's about wisdom, and it's about how God loves us and how we are supposed to love Him. And I always feel like the next three verses are basically us being knuckleheads, our addiction. But if you have bitter jealousy and strife in your hearts, do not glory and lie against the truth. This is not the wisdom coming from down from above, but is earthly, sensual, devilish. For where envying and strife are, there is confusion and every foul deed. And Bob will probably get into it more later next week, when because if you read on, chapter 4 starts with how our pride will most assuredly breed strife among us, within us, and it just goes out, and it's craziness. You know, it's like an addiction. It's like I said, it's addiction. Lying, conniving, snaking, searching, just literally searching for an argument, searching for the next buzz that only lasts a little bit. You know, sometimes it's a couple seconds. Answering the cravings of our flesh rather than doing God's plan, which is do the next right thing. We're just being a knucklehead and following our own deceitfully wicked heart, which is somewhere in the book of Jeremiah. I read this book at the urgings of my addiction counselor. It's called Surfing with God. You read it, Michael? Surfing for God? You have it, but you haven't read it. Now, it's Surfing for God. It's not Hanging 10. It's more surfing the internet, and it's more for a porn addiction than regular addiction. But the principle of addiction is here. It's in here. It's every addiction is the same. And what it does to our brain. Mm-hmm. I wrote this down. It's a paraphrase from part of the book. God designed our brain to operate along nerve pathways called neuropathways. The brain is an intricate bundle of these nervous circuits. God intended these pathways to function in His perfect way. But addiction, habitual sin, changes all that. Every time we practice our addiction, or sense a craving for our God of choice, the brain sends a shot of a powerful chemical called dopamine along this newly created path, strengthening it as it goes. Dopamine is the chemical that gives us the high that we feel. This process is called neuroplasticity, and it's real. It's medically proven. The more we practice something, the stronger the path becomes. And this is not just addiction. This is like if we have a talent. The more we practice the guitar, the more our brain gets in tune to that guitar, to that talent. And the easier it becomes. Practice, like I'm an artist. I use my camera mostly, but when I took an art course in drawing, the more you practice your drawing, the better you become. And it's the same with addiction. The more we practice our addiction, the more defined the path becomes. It's like our addiction becomes a bulldozer followed by a paver, and it just creates this ultra-smooth path, and it becomes the path of least resistance. in our brain. And the more easy the path, the more likely it is to be followed, even if we don't want to. It becomes our nature. It's the nature of the flesh. But here's the cure. Here's the cure. Verse 3:17. But the wisdom from above is first pure, then peaceable, gentle, open to reason, full of mercy and good fruits, impartial and sincere. And a harvest of righteousness is sown in peace by those who make peace. And that peace can be made in our brain, in our mind, and in our soul. Only through a relationship with Jesus. Only through our relationship with Him. And either strengthening that relationship or re-strengthening that relationship in the case of a relapse. The key to rewiring our brain is to develop, become a disciple, basically. It's develop the information that I had from this book is to develop spiritual discipline, which is like discipleship or sanctification and Christian recovery. There's nothing better. Nothing works better than Christian recovery. Amen. Christ as the higher power. Amen. 12 steps in this book, the 12 steps that they go through, get one of these. If you don't have one, get one. Study the steps in here. I had 12 other topics: prayer, communication with God. You can't have a relationship without communication. Amen. The last thing you want to hear from God is what we've got here is failure to communicate. It's more than just use Matthew 6 with the Lord's Prayer, which we call the Lord's Prayer, as a guideline rather than repeating those 3 or 4 verses. Study them. Do what they say. Don't say what they say. You know what I mean? And pray that way. If you're not up to that, if you can't communicate in that way, just talk to Him. Just let Him know where your heart is. Let Him know how much you need His help. He knows already, but He wants you to let Him know. And He wants to help you. Meditation. The best scripture that I have found for meditation and positive affirmation is Philippians 4:8. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, meditate on these things. Philippians 4, verse 8. Yeah, right, Jim. Use it. Live by it. When you feel like worrying, turn to Philippians 4:8. All of these are attributes of God. You think on these things, you're thinking about God. Fasting, which not all of us can do, and not all of us think about it. It's not always just food. It can be other things. But it's basically a reminder of the source of all nourishment for our bodies, but also nourishment for our souls, for our minds. It's a time of soulful reflection. Romans 14:6, the one who observes the day observes it in honor of the Lord. The one who eats, eats in honor of the Lord. Since he gives thanks to God, while the one who abstains in honor of the Lord and gives thanks to God. Next is study, careful attention to the reality that God reveals to us through his Holy Scripture. Simplicity, Matthew 6:33, and it doesn't get any simpler than this. Seek first the kingdom of God and his righteousness, and all these things will be added to you. It can't, like I said, it can't get any more simple. Submission, placing God's will above our own. God gives us free will, or freedom of choice. When we submit our will to him, we are allowing him to guide us through life according to his plan and not the cravings of our flesh, which is usually the wrong choice. And I'm sure Bob will get more on this next week, because that's basically step three. And he's covering for step three on next Friday. Solitude, withdrawing from the world to spend time with God. And you think about it, even Jesus, who was God come to earth, had to do this in order to do his ministry. Matthew 14:23, and after he dismissed the crowds, this was after he fed the 5,000, he went up on the mountain by himself to pray. When evening came, he was alone. Service, supportive action toward others. For even the Son of Man came not to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom of many. Confession, acknowledging our sins with and to others in the community of faith. James 5:16, therefore, confess our sins to one another and pray. And pray for one another that you may be healed. The prayer of a righteous person has great power as it is working. And the healing, whatever our addiction is, it's usually a sign that something needs to be healed. Mm-hmm. And so a prayer and our confession and the prayer that goes along with it will heal us. I went through a prayer session one time, a prayer and healing session, and it was a while. It took a while. It was like 7 or 8 hours, and it was very uplifting and got me much closer than I had ever been to God. And it's something that we all should do. You need to be delivered from this thing that's causing us to drift away from God. Guidance, giving and receiving direction from others along the journey with Jesus. Acts 5:15-8. And God, who knows the heart, bore witness to them by giving them the Holy Spirit, just as he did to us. A celebration. Taking joy in what God has done. But God commends his love toward us in that while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. There's no better reason to celebrate than that. And finally, worship. Giving God glory through attributes, through attitudes and actions. And the verse I wrote here was for 1 Corinthians 14:26. What then, brothers, when you come together, each one has a hymn, a lesson, a revelation, a tongue, or an interpretation. Let all things be done for building up. And all of this, we shouldn't do alone. God doesn't want us to be lone Christians. We need other people. We need this. We need this more than just once or twice a week. I was at a conference one time, and the speaker said that if you really want to get close to God, you should be spending more than half of your days in fellowship, in meditation, and in community with others. So it's more than just church on Sunday, and it's this meeting on Friday, and you know, there you go, God, I have this relationship with you. I mean, think about it. if any of you have spouses or friends, just friends, how many of us will just say, well, I spent an hour with you this morning. Now, what more do you need? How much closer do we need to get? You know?
You said you did.
Huh? Well, I spend an hour with you every Tuesday, and that's plenty. Actually, it's 2 hours. So, now, I had a comment that I wanted to read from Steve Artimer in the Life Recovery Bible. It's on page 1604. It's James 3:13 through 18. Wisdom is essential to recovery. It must, however, be godly wisdom, not earthly wisdom. Earthly wisdom leads to selfishness and pride, invariably causing confusion and strife. True wisdom is based on the knowledge of God. Not just, this isn't here, but it's not just this knowledge, the head knowledge, but it's the heart knowledge. It's knowledge that comes from your heart. It's knowledge that you live, mm-hmm. not knowledge that you know. It brings peace and leads to selfless living and faith that works. It never distinguishes between groups of people, but treats everyone with respect and love. Godly wisdom allows us to admit our failures and rebuild our life from the ashes of defeat. It frees us from our destructive dependency. It helps us live for others and builds relationships that will support our recovery. And I'm going to leave you with this. The goal of our recovery should not be how long we can stay sober, but it must be strengthening our spirit to overpower our flesh.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you.